You look beautiful, honey.
You too.
Thank you. Yeah. I don't feel beautiful. I love that jacket. What is that? A stole?
It's what you call fur.
Fur.
Fake or real?
Well, I say it's fake, but it's real.
Is everyone in? Are all the participants here? The audience?
Yes, they are.
All right. Well, then I guess we will start. Before we start, I'd like to say that now we've all spent so much time together, I'm not the least bit nervous about being with so many celebrities. Welcome. On behalf of the Jewish Film Festival of Greater Sacramento Area, the Jewish Federation of the same area, and the Jewish Community Relations Council of Sacramento, welcome, welcome. Today's chat will be taped and will be available on our YouTube channel. You know, this film, Tango Shalom, has been seen by more people than any other film in our film festival. Ooh. Why? Because you kindly allowed us to show the film every day of the film festival. And for that, we're very grateful. And you have the biggest audience as a consequence. And I hope that many, many people will see this chat as we go along. So I'd ask you, Claudio, since I've had a lot of contact with you on the phone, if you would please introduce the cast for us.
You want me to introduce everyone?
Yeah, please.
Okay, all right. We'll start with the big celebrities first. That's Renée Taylor. Can you raise your hand? No, everybody knows Renée Taylor right there. And Lainie Kazan.
There is she
on?
Is.
Is Lainie Kazan on?
There she is.
Okay, great. Lainie
hi,
Kazan.
Hi, Claudio.
Can okay, hi, me? Hi. Yes, yes, great. So I'm introducing everyone. We have Karina Smirnoff from Dancing with the Stars. We have Judi Beecher, who plays the lead female.
Hang up the phone. Okay, darling. All right.
Yeah. So we have Jos Laniado, who plays the male lead, the rabbi, the Hasidic rabbi from Crown Heights. One of the two Laniado brothers. We have Gabriel Bologna, the director of our movie, who is also the son of Renée Taylor and Joseph Bologna, who also co-wrote the film with us and co-produced the film with us. Did I miss anybody? No, I hope not.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
In many ways, this is a family venture, at least between two families. And we see that in the credits and of course on screen. And Renée, I'd like to talk with you first.
Okay.
Certainly this film means a lot to you in many ways. Could you tell us a bit about how you are connected to this film emotionally?
Oh, well, it was a work of love, which is what creativity is, love's work. To work with my son, to work with my darling husband, who I adored and still do after 52 years of marriage, my friend Lainie Kazan, who I've known longer than my husband even.
But we're not married.
But who knows, we may be someday.
Yeah, maybe.
The way the world is going.
I love you.
I love you. So we've just, it was just a fun every day. And it was, we laughed a lot. And we were very fortunate because wherever we went, I said, oh, you'll never get the Muslims. never get them to be in it. And they were. Wherever we went, I said, you'll never get the Sikhs to be in it, but they were. Oh, you'll never get the Orthodox rabbis to let us use the temple. Oh, they did. I was just surprised. Wherever I said, what did you do? Bribe them with bagels? They said a few. So wherever we went, we were supported, and they were delighted to be a part of this adventure. And it was a great adventure. And we all would have done the movie for nothing, and we practically did.
Well, that joy comes through. Very much this is an ecumenical movie. Besides being a comedy, a dance film, it's also a multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-religious film.
Yes.
And I'd like to ask the Laniado brothers what this film has to do with Convivencia, the company that you're involved in. Tell us about it.
Josh, you want to start?
You go ahead. You go ahead, Claudio. You know, go ahead.
Okay. All right. La Convivencia means living with it. The time, it was just right before 1492, when the Muslims, the Jews, and the Christians used to live and work in peace and harmony. So Convivencia Forever Films, our company from the Laniado brothers, was made from that premise that basically we wanted to make movies which will open doors of dialogue, enlarge the doors of dialogue that are open, raise the level of human consciousness, and have a positive social change. You know, there's the concept of the laws of Noaid, which is very common in all main religions, you know, thou shalt not kill and so forth and so on. Our movie wanted to be entertaining without being preachy. The director will speak to you more about the characters, the complexity of the characters and so forth and so on. The important thing was for our perspective, from our perspective was to go to these locations, connect with the people, learn about their culture and their religion. They can learn about ours, you know, what are common things. And in the process of making a movie about connecting with all people, all kinds of people, we're already doing the process. We're already connected with these people. The director will mention something about the Sikh, how the Sikh people were very welcoming and all the peoples. So I think that's a very important part of the process of making this movie. We had a lot of obstacles and a lot of miracles, and I think the director can talk about that more. And Jos, you want to say something?
I think basically you said about the Convivencia, it's that, you know, when we formed the company, it was one of the premise of the company. And I mean, I got inspired, you know, from, let me tell you how I got inspired.
Sure.
I go to the Kaaba house in Brooklyn Fridays for Shabbat, and I go to, you know, for the holidays. And during Purim a few years ago, I went to, you know, to see rabbi what they're doing. And they had a couple of drinks. And the next thing you know, they're doing break dancing on the floor. And I said,
What holiday was it?
For Purim. I said, yeah.
It was Purim.
So basically, I said to myself, what if one of these rabbis gets a message from HaShem to dance the tango to save his school? And I started writing. This is how I got inspired by Chabad House and Purim.
Thank you. And on that note, Gabe, talk to us a little bit about the neighborhood that you constructed and the major players in that neighborhood.
Well, if anyone hasn't been to Crown Heights, I strongly suggest they should go there, especially if they don't have the money to travel to Israel, because it's like being in Israel. I mean, everywhere you look, there are kosher restaurants and Hasids on their way to shul. And you got to pick yourself up some babka bread, which may be the greatest. You could call it a dessert, but you could also call it a bread. One of the greatest food items in the world. And, you know, when we were shooting in this neighborhood, every single day we were blessed with some divine intervention. I could tell you some amazing stories. Like we found a brownstone that's supposed to take place in the Yehuda household. And there are so many scenes in this brownstone for Rabbi Yehuda and his family. The person who owned this brownstone was a man named Rabbi Yehuda. And every day he would pray with us, and we would shoot scenes that to this day, I don't know how we accomplished it. I mean, when you shoot a scene with 19 people in a room, I mean, it could take you a week to shoot it all out. We would shoot it out, you know, in a half a day. And I was marveling at it. And Rabbi Yehuda said to me, you know, Rabbi Schneerson, who, by the way, is the, you know, most famous of all modern rabbis. And he asked Rabbi Schneerson if he should buy this home. And Rabbi Schneerson said, not only should you buy this home, but amazing things will happen here. And literally, it was like that. I mean, we are the first film ever to shoot at 770, which is the pillar of the, you know, Lubavitch movement. And we had a level of authenticity that has never been seen in a Jewish film. And by the way, the same goes for shooting in a Sikh temple and in all the other respective religions that we shot in.
Thank you.
How about the miracles that happened? You know, remember when it rained?
Oh yeah, my goodness. Yeah. We had a sequence where Rabbi Moshe Yehuda has all these experiences in New York City in the rain. Well, getting a rain machine and closing down the streets of New York City is an impossibility, even for a Spider-Man movie. So we figured we'll just do it in post. We had five non-consecutive scenes that took place in the rain. Every single one of those scenes, it rained on those days only. And we had tons of experiences like that.
Yeah, that's amazing. So many obstacles and yet so many miracles. And I said, well, we got to finish this movie one way or another, you know, and thank goodness, you know, we had Jos Bologna, who co-wrote the film with us, who produced it with us, and was able to make it to his scene. You want to talk about that, the game, about the scene, or what happened with the...
Actually, my mom would be better to explain.
Okay, Renée, you want to talk about
that? He saw it firsthand.
Yeah, you want to talk about how Joseph Bologna, you know, made it to that scene and what happened in the interim and his chemo and all that stuff, yeah.
The night before he was to be operated on for cancer, he did the scene in the church, and I said, Joe, you sure you want to work? You sure you don't just want to sit quietly someplace and pray? And he said, no, this is like praying for me. This is acting in this movie is a joy for me. And I would be very deprived if I didn't do it. And so with that, he entered into it.
He survived like more than a couple months than what the doctor said. So how many years did he survive, Gabe?
3.5 years.
3.5 years instead of a couple months. It's like almost like he had something to live for, right?
Yes.
Right, Gabe?
He loved
it. Yeah.
And he was living for this success of this movie, never dreaming that we would win the film festival in India, that this movie would speak to India.
Exactly.
And to Montreal and to Toronto, we really feel that it's everything has been a miracle for us. And even to getting a great tango dancer, we said, where are we going to find a girl that's a great tango dancer? We'll never find anybody.
Actually, we have somebody to thank for hiring Karina. And
Lainie said,
Lainie Kazan. Lainie said, I know just the person. And I was so frustrated because we had seen everybody in town. You'd see people who could act but couldn't dance, see people who could dance who couldn't act. And Lainie, how did you know Karina?
Don't tell them the truth.
Did we lose Lainie?
No. Here I am.
Oh, there you are.
Can you hear me?
I can't see you.
Yeah.
Oh, there you are.
Yeah.
Karina, how did I meet you? I'm out.
Remember, I was torturing you because I really wanted to learn how to sing.
Oh, right. Came to me
to coach her for a play on Broadway.
Lainie was the sweetest. She never let me lose hope.
Wow.
And a brilliant talent. And I, to Gabe, I have just the person. And then they met, and of course she got the role. That's what happened. I guess she danced and sang and did everything for the producers. And she was perfect. She was perfect.
I and love funny. You. And funny too.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. No, that was amazing. So in the beginning, I think Lainie and I would do maybe what, twice a week. Where, and if, ironically enough, we would practice only one song because I only needed to do one song for the audition. And I think when she realized that there was a better part, a dancing part versus a singing part, that's how it happened. But as you can see, the character, the personalities, the charisma in this group is fantastic, which makes the dynamic so much fun.
Then they well, say, where are they going to find a beautiful actress to play the wife? You'll never find her. You'll never find her because most beautiful actresses don't want to play a plain Jewish wife. But Judi was willing to.
Oh, thank you, Renée.
And Judi, as well as being a beautiful wife and a long-suffering wife of the rabbi, you were quite a remarkable mother. Tell us about those kids that played your children in the film.
How, because we had, you know, I had five kids in the movie, and they were all different. And so it was interesting because when I was first cast in the film, because everyone had different tones of skin, they were very different from you know, Jos and I. And originally they had wanted me to be Israeli, right, Jos? I was supposed to be a dark-skinned Israeli, so I tried to make my skin darker. but that didn't work, to mix in with all the kids. I thought the casting was real. It was very, it was good because it wasn't typical of what you know, like it's everyone true. Looks the same and everyone. So I enjoyed being an on-screen mother since I don't have kids of my own.
Well, you're very convincing.
I thought it was fascinating that the kids looked a lot like Jos's kids in real life. You know, Jos is Sephardic from Egypt, just like his brother Claudio. And he has kids that are of every different shade, which is so interesting.
And one of the children, one of them was his real daughter.
That's right. His actual daughter, Shira, played his daughter, real stretch. Yeah. By the way, she sings a wonderful song in the film as well at the end credits.
Yeah, Justine Laniado.
Really beautiful.
Don't forget the
name. Yeah. And I just wanted to say this project, you know, Convivencia, and I was attracted to this film. You know, in 2012, I kind of had this spiritual awakening where I wanted to really do projects that did something to change the consciousness of the planet. And this film does that in such a, you know, it really is about bringing different cultures together and people together. It's the peace tango, Tango Shalom. It's the peace tango. It's a way to come and just bring people together. And it just really drew me to the project when I first heard of it, when Claudio first told me about the film. So I think it's a really beautiful film. I'm very happy to be a part of it.
And it does bring people together, like in Karina's tango studio.
You know, Jos started writing it, then I got on, then Jos Bologna just put it all together with all his expertise in writing. You know, he's the Oscar nominee writer, you know, with Renée as well. So we were very grateful that, you know, we connected with him, and then we went to Beverly Hills, we wrote, And then with all the obstacles, including his pancreatic cancer, which was sad to experience that, we were willing to wait whatever it was to make sure that everything is done properly for this movie, because it was his last movie and we wanted to make sure that, it would be a tribute to him, and to his legacy. So I think that was very important.
So Karina, in many ways, this is a dance film. Now that you've seen the film probably several times.
Yes.
How did it come out? What did you think as far as the choreography and the different dancers?
Let me interrupt you a second. I think Lainie and Renée might have another commitment. It's up to them if they want to stay, but I think they have another commitment. Is that right, Renée, Lainie?
I could stay a little while.
Okay. Yeah, Lainie, I have a question for you, so please stay. The next question's for you. Okay. All right, go ahead, Karina, please.
Well, first of all, the choreography was quite unique to begin with, because you, in tango, you need that physical connection. Yeah, you manipulate each other's body weight, so you need that. But it was quite amazing to help create the choreography. We had a Jordi, the guy who is quite a phenomenal dancer, and he actually was the guy who left. See, Claudio, I can't do it. Stop me. I want to tell the script. Okay.
No, I'm not going to stop.
It was amazing, Fred. It was wonderful choreography. I love being a part of it, but I can't tell you any more stories because I can't keep secrets, apparently.
We understand.
You had to dance in a very special way.
Exactly.
Right? So it was very special.
Very special, exactly. Very special. But, anyway,
but it did take a lot of creativity and a lot of trials and tests to make it to what it is today. And it was phenomenal to be a part of the journey into it.
By the way, Karina Smirnoff's debut movie, it's the biggest role that she's had so far. So I hope all her followers will see us, so that's very important.
Well, she's seen a lot on television. Mm-hmm. Lainie, you have had a very broad career from singing and the movies and television. Tell us a little bit about the style of the character you play in this film. And where the hell did you find her?
I know a lot of women like that. I was brought up in Brooklyn, and that neighborhood, that kind of woman, so familiar to me. So I kind of stepped into her, and I had a great director. He is so wonderful. Gabriel is just the most wonderful, and I'm not surprised. I've known him before he was born, so I'm thrilled to have been a part of this project. Claudia and Jos, I mean, they were just so wonderful, and of course, my friend Renée. To work with her is just simply perfect. I mean, we just work together. It's like a hand glove. And we have great humor between us, and hopefully intelligent. And we've worked together so many times. I mean, we've kind of grown together, And I think she's a comic genius. So I just had so good. And those scenes, it was so simply hilarious. And Gabriel allowed us to do anything, and the comfort, the ability to relax and be who we wanted to be, and even say what we wanted to say. I know in that last scene, calling all those names, and I had a freedom there. So that's kind of the feeling I had in doing the film. I believe I read the script a long time ago, and then it was rediscovered when Renée and Joe got it. And fell in love with the script and I fell in love with the character. And I love the project. I just think it's amazing.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Gabe,
tell us a little bit about the religious communities that you worked with. I was especially curious about how you did get cooperation from the Sikh community.
You know, it was really interesting. When we shot in the Sikh temple, the Sikh priest there, he pulled me aside and he said, you know, we Sikhs are the Jews of India because we've been oppressed for so long in India. And I was just so amazed that he could talk in that context. And, you know, we had a scene that had 100 extras. And as you know, I mean, it costs a lot of money to have those extras. And it came with the Sikh temple. And we were so grateful because it's this very, very traditional Sikh wedding that we see. And those are real Sikhs. And when I was about to start negotiating the price for everyone, the Sikh priest said, we don't want any money in exchange for IMDb credits. So we have more IMDb credits with Indian names than in a Bollywood film. And, you know, what's so fascinating about this movie is also how music plays into each culture. You know, there's a 7-piece liturgical band that plays beautiful instruments played during the ceremony, the Sikh ceremonies that we recorded live. Yes. And it was just incredible. I mean, we've heard a Catholic choir before, and although we actually got a choir from the Vatican, believe it or not. To see how different cultures experience music, Yasir, who played the role of the imam, he actually sang the call to prayer, the Islamic call to prayer, which is very musical in the mosque scenes. And I think of anything that I walked away with is how important music is in all its forms, whether liturgical or not, in all these different cultures and religions.
Thank you very much.
I'm gonna say goodbye.
Yeah, go ahead. Okay, Lainie. Thank you very much.
Again, and thank you so much.
And I'm sorry for the technical issues, but we made it.
It's okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, Lainie.
Good to see you.
I have to go too, but I want to say something about the director. Not because he's my son, but because he is the most wonderful director that I ever worked with.
I second that emotion.
Most supporting, the most encouraging, the most freeing, the most talented. And he kept saying to me, cry more, Ma, cry more. I'd say, more? He said, yeah, like, remember when I was 7 and my cat ran away and you were crying and you told me, Gabe, your cat ran away. Like that, Ma, like that.
Incidentally, I will say my mom played a role that she's never played before. You know, she would tell me these stories about her mother, Frida, how she'd wake up cry throughout the entire day and go to sleep crying. And it was so great to see my mom play this role because I never knew my grandmother, Frida. You know, she passed when I was like 3. You know, because my mom often plays the exact opposite of those types of roles, like, you know, more vim and vinegar, bombastic. And it was great to see my mom finally play someone Hamisher.
My mother would cry when she was happy. She would cry when she was scared. She would cry when she was angry. That was the only emotion that she was comfortable in. But in those days, you know, women didn't get angry. Women didn't express fear. So that was the emotion that was open to her. And she knew every octave in pain.
Where was she from?
She was from Russia.
Russia.
My father was too, yeah. Mm. That's why it's so strange that I'm happy. But my son cries a lot.
My mom would tell me this story, how her grandfather had two grooves on his shoulder from pulling the ox cart.
Carrying back in Russia. Up the mountain. He had two holes in his shoulders from being the family ox.
Wow.
Wow.
Oh.
One thing that's, before they leave, I wanted to share that I just learned about this, that my brother was shining shoes when he was like, I think 12 or so. And I was shining shoes when I was 11. And Joseph Bologna was shining shoes as well. And also Gabe was shining shoes. So these are people who are shining shoes and ended up doing the American dream. I mean, this is unbelievable.
Yeah, you know, that's an interesting story. Yeah. On my Italian side of the family, we were called bootblacks, and I'm a fifth generation bootblack. And there's this famous story where a little young Italian shoe shine boy convinced Joe Kennedy to sell his stocks on Wall Street, because my family had a shoe shine concession on Wall Street. And that shoe shine boy was my granduncle Pat, and the owner of the shoe shine concession was my great grandpa Giuseppe.
Wow.
And so that's interesting. You guys shine shoes as well.
We're gonna have the Laniado Bologna shining shoes concession. It's coming up next week. Okay. And we're gonna have all these cast members as part of the job. They're gonna come and help us out.
If we don't sell this movie, we're gonna probably do the shining shoes. I'm telling you.
So basically, when every Bologna member turned 13, we would shine shoes on the stand. And my dad did it from 13 till he went to Brown University. But I only had to do it for 2 weeks. And into the third day, my knuckles were bleeding. I could barely move my hands. And I'd come home to my mom and dad and say, please, I can't do any more of this. You know, so it just goes to show you, you know, what my family had to go through. I mean, my grandfather shined 1 million shoes to pay for his son to go to Brown University. Wow. I mean, you just wrap your head around that.
And at Brown University, what did your father major in?
Fascinatingly enough, art history.
Wow.
And ironically, that was his technique in acting, in writing. Everything was through the prism of the Renaissance. When he would rewrite a script or come up with an idea, it was always on Renaissance principles of balance and three-act story structure. And so I think that's the biggest takeaway from our movie, Tango Shalom, is really the contribution of art and how it manifests in different people's lives.
Massimo Zeri was somebody who contributed to that, right?
He was our DP, who, believe it or not, worked with De Sica and Antonioni and even Fellini.
How old was he when he worked with Fellini?
He was a young, starting out cameraman, you know, 19 years old. And interestingly enough, he is the one who got us this beautiful Catholic church where my dad got diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. We had to find a church immediately to start shooting in before his cancer surgery. And he got us this amazing church because he was friends with the priest. The irony was he's Buddhist. Massimo is a lifelong Buddhist. He converted to Buddhism. So we have every religion, you know, in our film.
Thanks. Jos, I wanted to ask you a question. One of the most moving scenes in the film, for me anyway, is to see you not as a tango dancer, but as the teacher. And then when I look through your biography, I see that in fact, you have been a teacher.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about those scenes in the yeshiva.
Well, in real life, I'm...
I think Lainie wants to say goodbye.
We said bye. Bye-bye. Go ahead,
Lainie. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for being with us.
My pleasure. Always. I love Renée. You.
Yeah, love you too. Bye, Renée.
Bye. Love you all.
Bye, Renée. Bye, Lainie. Kisses.
Gabe.
I'll see you. Bye, honey.
Gabe, call your mother.
We have to make a sequel so I can see my mom more often.
Okay.
Bye.
Love you, Mom.
So I was
teacher. Please, yeah. Go ahead.
So basically, I was a teacher. I became a teacher actually because of some Vietnam War going on, and I didn't want to go to the army, and I felt I just came to this country, so I signed up to become a teacher. So I started teaching languages, Spanish and French, and one of the teachers. Was an English teacher. He had a show going on to Twelfth Night, Shakespeare. Yes. And I went to see him. So, and he kept on coming to my class because I was teaching role playing. We're teaching the language of role playing, singing the guitar. He says, "Why don't you take acting?" I said, No. Me an actor never happened. So I decided I went and I took an acting class, actually HB Studio, which is famous. And then at this, I got the bug, and that from then on it was like all acting, really, basically, you know. And then I, you know, I was teaching for about 8 years, and then I said I got some acting jobs all of a sudden, so I left teaching for about 15 years, did only acting, and then I decided to, you know, get into, you know, writing. Because I was getting all these parts as butler, as the lovers, and stuff like that. And I said, I want a real serious role. And this, I got into writing Tango Shalom.
Thank you very much. I believe at this point, we're going to start taking some questions from our viewing audience. Is one of my colleagues there to start with the questions?
Well, I am here. But there's only one question, which I asked, so I'm going to ask it. I want to ask, with your production company, do you have any additional films in the works? And then you made a comment that I'd like you to expand on, that it was about the intersection of the different cultures and religions. That was part of your motivation. So could you talk about those two things? And any new films, and then that motivation?
Yeah, traveling, being like refugees, like Jewish refugees from Egypt, my parents, my grandparents, they all were born there, and we saw that there was an essential common human thing between all human beings, all right, and it was whatever we experience as human beings, everybody has a similar way of experiencing, you know, because of the human aspect of it. There are different perspectives, there are different ways of seeing things, of course, you know, and the whole idea was because the Noaid was made, I believe, the seven laws of Noaid were the common beliefs like not thou shalt not kill and so forth, they're all in the major religions, all right? And my belief was HaShem, the Almighty, made this because he wanted a blueprint for people who think differently, who believe differently, all right? He gave us the Torah to the Jews, but he also gave the seven laws of Noaid to everyone else and the Jews. The seven laws of Noaid pre-existed 2,000 years prior to the Torah being given to the Jews. So with time, there were a lot of different perspectives and, you know, and going away from different perspectives of from that to whatever, you know, whether it be Chasidic, whether it be Reform, whether it be whatever, or, you know, and our goal was to somehow reignite the commonality between different Jews, but not only different Jews, but also different people with different beliefs. We're all human, and we all came from some kind of a suffering experience, you know, and all, you know, like the Asians now is very, you know, thing that's going on with the Asians, the Black Lives Matter movement, the Japanese after World War II, when the United States put the Japanese in concentration camps, basically, you know, right after, you know, and the Chinese who helped build the railroads, most of the railroads of the United States, the Chinese were a big part of it. You know, and I think people don't realize that we're all human. We all have a special talent. We all have a gift to give to the world. And everyone needs to have that opportunity to be able to do that. Some people don't have the opportunity because of financial, because of illness, because of retardation, and so forth and so on. We want to reignite this feeling that we're all one people, and that's the mainly what I want to say.
Beautifully stated. Thank you.
But then I also wanted to know if you have any other productions in the works, and are they inspired by a similar motivation?
Well, Josie has some projects, and I'm starting to write something. He's starting to write. I think the director Gabe, he's got. I don't know. You want to talk about your projects, Gabe?
Oh, I have a bunch of projects. They all take place in Europe. Karina, I'd love to know what's going on with you. What, anything new? Are you doing any competition judging or?
Yes, actually.
In the era of COVID, how do people even dance? And
yeah, it's all through the screen and telepathic. Right now we're working on this new technique. You don't physically touch, but you telepathically feel each other's energy.
Sounds like Tango Shalom.
Yes.
We should get a commission.
No, but
it's funny that
this movie is out is like, it couldn't be more perfect.
Yeah.
You know, with everything that's happening, this movie is like a feel-good movie for so many different types of people. So I think there was a perfect time. Right now, this is it.
Judy, you have projects also.
Yeah, right? I'm working on a project. I'm directing a documentary right now about my mother, who was a hidden child in the Holocaust and who escaped by herself. She was hidden, and she was from Germany, hidden in Switzerland, separated from her parents. And then she escaped by herself when she was 6 years old across the French-Swiss border.
Wow.
And I'm working on that right now. The working title is Run Runya, The Kindness of Strangers. And I recorded my grandfather's story. They escaped as well, my grandparents. They hid in the ceiling of the detention camp that they were held in Camp Reefsalt. They were one of 86 people to survive the camp because they hid in the ceiling, and they were reunited together. And my grandfather, you know, I recorded the whole story. So the basis of the film is that we follow my grandpa's story back to Europe, to all the places where it happened. And my mom discovers on her own what happened to herself because she had blocked everything out. And as things are happening,
how did they eat? How did they sustain themselves? How did they eat? I mean, you know, if you're staying in the
kindness of strangers, that seriously,
in a detention,
if they didn't have people help them along the way, so many people helped them. So many people hid them. You know, they
were. What it was a sympathetic guard. I mean, how did they? Who fed them in the detention camp?
So they were in the camp. They were hiding in the roof of a school. They found a hiding place that if anything happened, they could go up there. And they started emptying the camps. Emptying the camp, bringing all the prisoners to the death camps. And so when that started,
so they survived the deportation.
Women warned them. Oh, a wow. woman warned them who was part of the organization to save the children, the Swiss Red Cross. It was someone who worked with my grandmother. They set up a little school within the camp for the children, and my grandmother worked in the school. And so they went into the schoolhouse and they hid in the schoolhouse. So someone told them, and they had a plan in case something happened. And this woman went and would bring them food outside the door every night. You know
the name of that camp?
Camp Reefsalt. Camp Reap Salt. It was in the south, in the Pyrenees, in the Pyrenees, in the south of France.
Wow.
And Gabe, you're doing something similar, right? Brundy Bar or?
Oh, I have so many Holocaust projects. You know, I feel very close to that genre.
Well, there are a few more questions, unless there's some more projects that people want to tell us about.
Let's end with a few more questions. Go ahead. What are they?
All right. For Jos, what led you to Shabbat and how has this affected you as an actor, specifically with the challenge of not working on Shabbat?
Well, it's funny because I go to Shabbat every Friday or, for Shabbat. And we shot this movie and we did not work on Shabbat. We did not work Friday. If we had to finish the scene on Friday, guess what? When we saw the sun coming down, we stopped. And everybody was, happy with that. Even Gabe said, okay, guys, the sun is coming down. Let me finish. One more scene. No, that's it. So we really stuck with the Shabbat. Friday, Saturday, no work. And we stuck with it from the beginning. And it was really, it's like, in the morning, I had to get up, be at the set at 5 o'clock in the morning. I broke my tefillin with me because I do tefillin every morning. So it was like, everybody was like watching, and even sometimes Gabe was putting tefillin on and praying. It was very touchy, it was like a lot of faith, a lot of connection. It was like, I wanted like this never end, shooting this movie. I was so passionate about it. Everybody was so involved, and they understood the project and they wanted to get involved. And we got so many people involved in this movie who didn't want any money from us. They just want to be involved with this movie. And it's unbelievable what happened.
Well, like Karina said, it was a feel-good movie.
Yeah.
So here's a question for Karina. What was it like for you to have the storyline of having a daughter with a medical challenge and working with the actress who played your daughter?
Well, I think this is probably the biggest fear a parent can have, when you don't know how to make your kid's life better. And I think now that I'm a mom, like I understand, I wish I had that experience of becoming a mom when I was filming, but it's, I think whether you have kids or not, this is something that always becomes, in the back of your mind, that's something that you worry about and pray and hope that the baby is healthy. So it definitely was, not easy. I Googled quite a bit about the information of how people cope with it. But in reality, the girl who played the daughter was very sweet, very articulate, very intelligent, a very beautiful actress. I think she got a part in a sitcom after the film because her mom was texting me about the girl's success for a while. It wasn't easy. At the same time, I know a lot of friends, even from the dancing community, who have kids with disabilities, and how they approach parenthood, how they approach speaking to the kids and not having them ever feel that they are maybe different from others. So yeah, it was very educational, very scary. Yeah, because of course you don't wanna put anything like this out in the universe, but also very, very telling of the maturity, the level of maturity that the person needs to have to be able to cope with something like this.
Actually have another question for you, Karina. And this is from Brenda Water. She says, I want to see you act more. We met at the Santa Barbara International Film Festival in 2014.
Yes. Was that for Across Grace Alley with Ralph Macchio? Yes, Brenda?
She's nodding her head. Yes.
Yes. Yes. It was a coming of age story for that movie where a young boy and a lady kind of help each other. But yes. So, I love acting. I think acting is similar to dancing in many ways. It's an emotional release. It's like after a really good practice or performance and the dance or even acting, you feel like you've went through an emotional roller coaster, and then you feel happy and sad and you tired and you inspired. So yeah, I mean, I would love to act more if only I could make a career out of it financially, you know, but yes, anywhere yeah. where there is a camera, spotlight and some music, sign me up.
Mm-hmm. Well, if the movie, exactly. When the movie sells, a distributor, you know, picks us up, then that's the time you're going to like shoot like up the stars. You're already a star. You're going to be a bigger star.
Definitely. Yeah, but isn't it, this is so much more than just money at the end of the day. Because time goes by and then you look back and you remember and you relive certain moments. This is like of course we need to have means to live on, but this is the passion. This is the love. This is the medicine for the heart, you know?
Yeah. And we appreciate you being here for us.
Thank you, Claudia.
Dave, are there any other questions?
Well, Tevin says he wants to see some basic tango steps. So I don't know if that's a request, not necessarily a question.
You know, on Zoom, you only dress up halfway. This was not disclosed to me before the interview.
My wife and I were going to do some steps for you guys. Whenever you're ready.
Thank you. Okay. Go right ahead.
Yeah, before you do that, I just want to say that if anybody wants to know what's going on with the movie, they could always go to our social media and also to go to our YouTube page. We have the trailer there, the link. The more people spread the word, you know, like clicking on the YouTube trailer or, you know, or YouTube page, I mean, Facebook page, you know, and so forth and so on, the better chance we have. Such a big competition now. So we need you, the audience, to help us out in that. If you can help us out with that, that would be a great, you know.
Thank you. It looks like our milonga is about to start.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is Amelia?
I feel like you're cheating on me, and I should be there. I know this is wrong, but I can't help it. What are you doing, Jos?
Hey, I'm his wife. I should be dancing.
I know
him.
This is so wrong.
He's dancing with his real wife. This is wrong.
Too many partners.
My partner, she's getting ready. You get a few minutes, but I want to talk to you a little bit about tango. All right? Can you guys see everything about him?
No, we don't see your feet. We don't see your feet. You got to go backwards. More.
Okay, more. Let me just move the camera. Wait, let me move the camera down a little bit.
There you go.
Yeah.
Perfect.
How's that?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. So basically in tango, you have to learn to do the balance. There's the word cab, connection, axis, and balance, basically. So basically I want you right now, you guys, if you want to start dancing with me, whoever in the background, just stand up straight.
Are we all going to dance with them?
And then you can just go back and forth, okay? That's where you get the axis, all right? That's it, right? All right, so basically in tango, any dance, you have to learn to listen to the music. You dance to the music, not only the steps. It's not gonna help you be a good dancer. You gotta listen to the music and then dance to the music, okay? So some basic steps I'm gonna teach you today, basically, come. Yeah. Yeah, what I wanted for my partner, I'm gonna show you a couple steps. I want you to like, for the lead, I'm the lead and the woman is the follower. So basically I'm gonna go back with the right foot. So when I go back with the right foot, my partner will go forward with her left foot. Okay. So I'm gonna go down this way and then I'm gonna open up and close. Okay. So basically in tango it's like walking basically. You're just walking. You're walking, find the balance, just walk. okay? You walk. Okay, you walk backwards, walk forward, okay? And listen to the music, right? So, again, you're gonna go back with your right foot to lead. The woman's gonna go with the right, and then this way, okay? Then you just wanna walk. 1, 2, 3, 4, together, okay? And do that again.
So you start with your left foot. You start with your left foot, right?
Yeah, start with the lead, start with the right foot.
Yeah.
The woman start with the front, the left foot. Forward.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're gonna go.
You go this to the way, side with the left foot. Up.
Right. And then you're gonna move up. 1, 2, 3, 4. That's the basic stuff for now. All right. How's my partner doing?
Amazing.
I'm right here.
Karina, can you come over because my partner is not here? I don't know. Can you
please come in. Here?
Okay. Now, my DJ, Jet, come here. Come. Come. This is my DJ, Juliet.
Hi, Juliet.
Hi, Juliet.
Hi.
And this is my DJ assistant. DJ. Jennifer.
Oh. Hi. Hi, guys.
This is Amelia, my partner, yeah. Wife.
Yeah.
Hi, Amelia.
How you doing, guys?
Daddy, good to see you. Come. Daddy, which one?
No. Over here.
Can you stay with Jenny? You can stay with Jenny. But make sure that it's not
too, okay. So, Jenny, come. So anyway, another step we're gonna do. When you listen to the music, put the music on.
When you're coming, wait. Come in, brother.
This again. The second man, the lead. Come.
Did you put this on?
Come. And so this is the okay. So basically you start with the lead goes with the right foot back. Close embrace is when you keep the woman like this. You see her hand, she's right in the axis over here. Chest together. So what you do is you start, you put pressure with the arm, okay, and you kind of push slowly with your body, okay, to the left.
You could do it without touching too. Some people don't want to touch, you know, so.
Okay, so what I'm gonna do is like, basically instead of putting chest together at the beginning, just put your hand on her shoulder, she put her hand on your shoulder, and you just walk. But when you walk, keep the tension together, okay, always. Okay, you move left foot.
Yeah, and the woman, when she goes backwards, she's gotta extend the leg back and slide it. You know, it's like ice skating, you know.
Okay, so then it's eventually, when you take your hand off, the chest becomes the hands, you know, you become Like this. See, she can put all her weight on me like this. Okay.
Are there any questions from the audience about this, the dancing, Fred? Any question from the audience?
There are all kinds of tango. There is traditional tango. There is a valse tango with a valse. There's a milonga. Okay. There is also now tango fusion and tango nuevo. So tango nuevo is mostly like you can put any music, like any music on, and you can do tango to it. Tango fusion is a combination of blue dancing, blue and tango. Okay. So they can go on forever with tango. Now, if you want to go tango in Sacramento, there's something called Sacramento River. I think it's in Pier Red. You go there, they're starting March 27th. They have an outdoor, I think, tango. And the rule is you have to wear a mask. You got to bring your own partner for now. And you can only dance with your partner. You cannot dance with anybody else. So you want to go.
So tango on the river. Fred, I just want to point out that Karina said that she has to leave. So
okay. Thank you very much, I Karina. Need to jump off.
We're all about late. To leave.
Thank you, Karina.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Karina.
Thank you so much, guys. Love you.
See you again soon.
Yes.
April 11th.
Yes.
Okay. Do some more dancing. So, what do you want us to do exactly? So
that's been fine. We want to thank you for your demonstration. It's what the public asked for, especially Brenda Jew Waters, and she got it. Thank you again to you and your wife. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very
much. On behalf of the Jewish Film Festival of Sacramento, I'd like to thank you all for sharing your talents with us this afternoon. It's been a wonderful experience. Thank you again. Farewell. Thank you.
Thank you for having us. Thank you.
Thank you for having us. Sorry. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye, sweetie.